CTO of Placester. I'm going to talk to him a lot about, you know, his story, how he went from, you know, well, how he started off and how he got to where he is today. The main goal here is I think role models are very important. Everybody looks up to somebody, sees somebody who's been through something that they've been through, and that can be an inspiration just that little bit to help you kind of keep moving forward in your life and getting to your goals. So the goal is to keep this going as a series. We're starting here with Frederick to talk about his story, how he, you know, trials, tribulations, successes, etc., and just to show you guys what he's been through. Frederick is, like I said, the co-founder CTO of Placer, started with W3 Edge, and then went to W3 Markup. So then he's a CTO, co-founder, I mean, the founding CTO of Mashable. So long story, but we'll get through it, and here we go.
Thanks. Can I start with some questions? Is that okay?
Yeah.
So, who out there is starting some kind of startup? Tech company? Some other guy? Like, just talk to me. What industries are you in? Just want to say things that are relevant to you guys. So,
social enterprise.
What is it?
It's social enterprise, web application, marketplace platform.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
Marketplaces are big. Anybody else?
Apparel,
okay.
Virtual reality.
Oh, wow. So like Oculus,
yeah.
That's pretty sick. What else? Anybody?
Distance learning,
that's big. So like competing with edX kind of stuff?
Or maybe for the location.
Okay. Cool. Anybody else want to share?
Media.
B2C mobile.
B2C mobile. That's interesting. Okay, so do you all have like co-founders? Like, you know, are you like early stage? By early stage, like maybe you didn't take any financing, you know, maybe you've only been doing it in a couple of years, you haven't made any money yet. Where are people in the process?
Early stage, putting together the development and the software.
So you're building a product, trying to figure out how, you know, how to put it together, and then you're going to market with it?
Yeah.
Anybody else?
Same
thing. Okay. Anybody else?
So we're early, but we have two products going to beta testing next month. And we have an outsourced tech team.
Cool.
And a team of about 30 engineers.
Awesome. Okay. And so I like to, whenever I do talks, I like to just be interactive. Like the biggest thing that's key for me is for you guys to get some value out of it. So appreciate you for spending some time with me here. Just in terms of, you know, what I've been through, I mean, it's a lot of the things that you would expect. I mean, the difference between, you know, when I started out about 15 years ago and, you know, where you guys are today. I mean, age doesn't really matter. It's more about the stuff that's available to you. You know, think about generational, like, you know, how hard it was for like previous generations to do anything compared to how it is today. So back then, I mean, it was like, you know, I remember Smashing Magazine and resources like, you know, that Envato makes, for example, for developers, or like Treehouse, things like that. No such thing, right? Distance learning just meant like you were in a big room and someone was yelling at you, right? It was like there was no such thing as a lot of the stuff that you have today. So you have a lot of advantages that, you know, make it a lot easier. Like another example is like Amazon Web Services. No one imagined it would be such a thing. However, all the patterns for how to make that kind of platform existed for a very long time. You just couldn't scale them because of economies of scale, right? So like, if you're very early stage, one of the things that I would encourage you to think about is what you can do to get an unfair advantage. Like, do you guys know what I mean when I say that? Like, can someone tell me what an unfair advantage is? And I don't mean like insider trading in the stock market, you know what I mean? I mean like, what is special about what you are doing that someone else would have a lot of trouble trying to duplicate? Right? Sometimes that is being first. Sometimes it is simple as being best. You know, sometimes it's like how you operate, right? Things like that. So that's one of the things that I learned over the years. So for example, starting out at W3 Edge, all I did there is I said, hey, I'm obviously not going to get a job after I finish that BU. I need to go make money, right? I realized as soon as you start wondering how much your rent is day over day, come out of your pocket, you start to think a little bit differently about how to make money, right? So that's where I was in, like, you know, 2003. and started with trying to drive passive income. So back then, virtualized web hosting was a thing. Started doing that, signed up all my friends and strangers, and started making, you know, thousands of dollars month over month, right? So that feels good. Then I was like, this grows too incrementally, because I didn't raise any money, right? I didn't get any help. I didn't get a loan or any of that stuff. So then I started selling services, because then I knew I could get, you know, someone to retain me for a period of time to do services month over month, or I could get a large contract and like start putting together an agency. Then around like, I guess it would be 2004, 2005-ish, I actually hired my first salesperson, didn't pay him any base salary, taught him how to sell, because I obviously had to learn how to sell to be able to do all this stuff, so school of hard knocks. Took that individual in 11 months from, you know, zero to $60,000 in commissions, right? So, you know, back then that was a big deal for me. Then what I started to realize is like there's just, you can never have enough money, especially if you're, you know, doing it on a performance basis, right? I just never really cracked the web hosting thing or figured out how to get, you know, folks to want to retain me as an individual without like a large group of other, you know, experienced professionals around me to, you know, contribute, right? So one of the things that I started doing probably before I met Pete Cashmore at Mashable is I looked at a business model where folks would give me their artwork and I would give them like a WordPress theme or templates, things like that, right? And what I did differently than everybody else, which is why I was thinking about an unfair advantage, is those folks were like outsources that I was competing with. So I did two key things. Thing one is I went online and I ranked for everything. Bought the domain. Like back then it's completely different. Now SEO and search marketing, all that stuff is extremely technical. But anyway, back then, very easy. I didn't really need to like read anything. You just have to like think hard enough and figure it out. So I beat them on Google. That was awesome. Next thing I did was I didn't try to develop the same type of customer. They were going for volume, right? I was going for deal size or account size. So they would get a $200 deal and they would do it in volume and I would drop a zero behind them. Completely different thing. In terms of how the team worked, I spent a lot of time on operations. So that meant, you know, as you know, a body of work comes in and then what goes out before you get paid, you know, streamlining that, which sounds, you know, easy, you know, generally speaking. Because like if we're doing some activity, let's say, you know, everybody's coming over for a cookout, we're gonna divide and conquer, and like you and me, we're gonna like do work the grills, right? We'll talk for a few minutes and we'll kind of operationalize that. And then as soon as we find out there's like 4,000 people coming over, think a little bit differently, right? So I'm talking about that level of play, like getting really precise with that. And then what I found was that it was really interesting to the folks who had come before me who were using a slightly different model, which was lucrative, but it was painful because they hadn't created their own unfair advantage, right? They hadn't improved their operations. They didn't like know how to go after a larger or let's say a richer customer, right? So like the work to develop a customer is always the same approximately. Does that make sense? So if you're making many of them, it's like that's pretty expensive, but if you get one that spends more money with you, that's better, right? It's more better return on investment just in that sales process. So they really liked the way that I did that model. I sold that business in like 11 months, okay? And then when I sold that, it was right around the time I met Pete Cashmore, and I was actually trying to pitch him along with Neil Patel, who's sort of Neil Patel. So like Crazy Egg, you know, ATS, Kiss Metrics, okay? So we were both pitching Pete Cashmore on social media optimization for Mashable, because it was just, he was in Scotland, it was like three or four people, you know, writing for him at the time. And so he couldn't keep the website up back then. And so he was just like, you're my CTO, right? Because I fixed it, right? Because I was like, I can't sell this guy anything if his business is like off, right? So I fixed it. And then I also around that time started getting more involved in open source. So back then, you know, WordPress was a little bit different than it is today, but right now it's like 25% of the web, right? It's a big deal. You know, I think that business is worth well over, I think it's $1.5 billion, I don't know if anybody knows that number. But they keep raising money, they don't have any trouble doing that. But anyway, when I started into that open source world, because, you know, Mashable was and is partially still run by WordPress, because it's a great tool for media, right, for publishing, I just found that it was too hard to scale it, to be even able to worry about how the business run or what the business did, right? Fortunately, the business model is straightforward. Make content, get engagement, and it became a movement, right? Like social media is now just a thing. You know, if you get a phone and you don't log into it with Facebook, like it means it's broken. You know, like the world is different today. But back then, that was a thing, so I went through this journey of just being more technical as my personal unfair advantage compared to everybody else, right? So what kind of degrees do you guys have? You know, what kind of technical backgrounds? Are you guys very technical? Are you on the marketing side? Are you less technical? Are you more on the, like, you know, all the other sides of the business, sales, you know, marketing, all that stuff?
Engineering.
That's great. So that's got to be your unfair advantage. For whatever reason, it's going to be like this for a period of time. Hopefully for a long time, if you are technically minded and you can work, let's say, cross-functionally, so just imagine a company that's got all the business units, right? You know, marketing, sales, accounts, engineering, products, you know, support, all those different teams. You can work cross-functionally and be technically minded, you're automatically a leader because marketing is now more technical than it's ever been. Building stuff is easier than it's ever been, but, like, you know, if you build a web app, you need to know like 17 different like languages and frameworks and stuff like that just to get started. Right? You don't have to be good at them, but you have to understand, you have to be aware, you have to be decisive to be a leader. And then, you know, you can also use tools better than your colleagues if you're technically minded, which is a big deal. So not to, you know, like control, manipulate, oppress your coworkers or, you know, or whatever else, but just to position yourself to have, you know, to be in a leadership role and kind of dictate where an organization grows, being technical is a big deal, right? It's just not gonna change. Be the same thing as, you know, actually I see this in the legal profession. Anyone in law that is very technically minded is like always the go-to person, not just to like figure out how to send an email with an attachment, but to usually make, you know, decisions about how a case gets built and like what the truth is. So anybody else technical? Good. All right, so I recommend it. Doesn't mean you need a degree, it just means you need to be
minded. Where do you say, like, where would you start? Let's say I'm not very technical at all. Like, is there certain languages that you prioritize, or where do you start in terms of that?
Well, one of the questions that I was going to come to is, you know, trying to make sure that everybody thought about at least having somebody that they look up to. So mentor means a lot of different things. Back when I started like working with mentors, I didn't really call them that. I didn't really think about it in that way. But really, the closest thing to a shortcut is a mentor. It's someone with experience that's gone through it before, whatever it is. Unfortunately, whatever they do, unless they're doing exactly what you've done and they did it 10 minutes before you, whatever they tell you is not going to be exactly what you need. But that's not the point. The point is, like, we're not omniscient. We don't want to learn every single lesson. It'd be like trying to make a tree by, like, you know, touching every branch and like figuring out where every leaf is. Like, that sounds stupid. Like, I don't even like saying that. That sounds awful. But that's the point. It's like there are patterns to things. There are principles, fundamentals, things like this. You can't really read them. You know, it's not bad to do that. It stimulates your mind. You get to think a little bit differently. But the most critical thing is to like spend time with people that have done anything remotely close to what you want to do. And, you know, I don't recommend having 17 at once. I recommend having one at a time in a particular area where you're trying to develop and replacing them, like outgrowing them, right? So I put out a podcast, I don't know when it was, a couple months ago, something like that, and a whole bunch of my old mentors that I even know that I thought of them as that sprung out of the woodwork. You know, they're all over the country now and doing different things, and, you know, a lot of them, I learned a phenomenal amount about, you know, how to run a business, how to be a leader, you know, like how to negotiate, how to do sales, like how to, you know, just tons and tons and tons of things, just to be able to have the concepts and principles in my mind. And then what I started to realize over the years is, like, for just about everything that you do, it's already a thing. That's why one of the things I was saying earlier is you need an unfair advantage. By already a thing, I'll give you an example. So we were working on a brand new office. So one of the challenges is the original space we got, it had some furniture, it didn't really lend itself to how the team needed to operate. People were sitting too close together, it wasn't what we needed. So we didn't have any money at the time to put into furniture, right? We needed to put our money into engineering and making products, right? You know, to have something to sell, you know, like, who cares if you sit on the floor, if you have nothing to sell, you're not in business, right? So that's pretty easy math to do in your head. So we stuck with those desks for a period of time, and then what I started to realize is, like, well, what we really need, since as the team grows and how people work together and as our culture changes, people need to sit in different places, they need to like function differently, right? Need to be situated relative to each other. different as we build our different business units, right? So that's not hard to understand, but what is hard to understand is, like, again, there was a name for the thing that I was trying to do when I tried to make sure that every single workstation was reusable, right? So everybody needs a personal space. That's not the topic. The topic is, you could go sit at this desk and you could sit at this desk, and the next day you'd be like, hey, we need to work closely, and you could switch, and it wouldn't be like moving stuff around, or wouldn't even be like, oh, it's not even possible, like, let's go do something different. Everybody would be able to do what's called hot desking. And so then when you think, take this a step further, okay, we filled up our space. You go from, you know, 35 people at the beginning of the year to like 80 people right now at Placester, okay, and like the year's not even over yet. So we ran out of space. So then we expanded to the space above. So that space happened to have cubicles in it. Everybody hates cubicles. I mean, it was like the monsters, like from the beginning of time. It was like you have to like stand up to like talk to people. It's terrible. Right? So that wasn't good. And so we had a plan, we had a budget and everything else to do, to keep doing hot desking, so that as the teams grew and changed, we could move people upstairs, downstairs, and everything else. Because if you've ever worked in an office, one thing you know for sure is you don't see the people on other floors. So you're trying to build a culture, you want people to think similar things, be aligned with the mission, understand the vision, be strong contributors, work well cross-functionally, you know, this team talking to that team, and like, oh, I'm not gonna go downstairs, it's too far, I'll figure it out, and they start guessing, you know, that's a good way for your company to get messed up, right? I mean, it's just like a no-brainer. It's like anything else. It's like, you know, I'm not going downstairs to eat dinner with the family, I'll eat later. It's like, you're missing out on everything that a family does, because that's where the family meets, is around the dinner table, right? Same idea. So anyway, the point is like, I didn't know that in 2011, someone else who had a similar problem coined the phrase hot desk, right? Like, I could, you know, do all types of meditation, and it wouldn't come to me that it was called hot desking, right? So this is what I mean. So take for granted that when you work with mentors and you learn things, maybe they used to call it something different 15 years ago, like nothing really gets invented. What you really need to do is you need to figure out what principles are going to be beneficial to you by working with people who solve similar problems. And then as you see yourself, you know, becoming successful, moving through the lessons that they're showing you, teaching you, spending time, like, you know, offering reactions and feedback to, look for the next person who has the qualities, attributes, you know, fruit on the tree that you want to have, right? And I only say it that way because it's fun to have like a personal mentor, you know, some kind of spiritual mentor, you know, professional one, like that's the different aspects of your being, like that's fine to go to split it up that way. But you don't want to get like, you know, just pretend, you know, Donald Trump and like, you know, Kobe Bryant pretend he's a phenomenal businessman. Like, you don't want both of those people at the same time. You need to focus, right? Because what you're learning, you want to like put it into practice. And if you're getting too much input, you, like, that's too hard to do, right? So, but anyway, so just to, is that the thing we were looking for there?
Yeah, sure. Okay.
So just to go back to the story real quick, spent time with Peter Cashmore early on in the business. I don't know, it's like number 5 or 6 on the team, something like that. And just focused on building products and media. I mean, one of the biggest keys is the channels in which you get your content out on and how well you adapt and understand how that channel works, right? So you know, working closely with Google and all the pre-release stuff and all the betas, things like that, that was like huge back then. But then obviously just focusing at the beginning was very key. So like now, Mashable goes across all different types of content channels. Back then, it was all social media, that was it. Today, it still has that stigma, makes it sound bad, but it has that reputation for understanding social better than everybody else, but that has transcended into being part of the platform. So if you're a brand and you go to Mashable, to like, you're interacting with the connected generation, because that's the origins or the unfair advantage that Mashable had, right, is like social media. So there's lots of other ways to build a business, but that's just, you know, part of the Mashable story. So while working on Mashable, I ultimately ended up moving to Florence, Italy, because why not? And then while I was there, I spent a lot of time working on an open source project, which was like, you know, kind of learned a little bit about how the community worked, and then started spending time like doing, you know, they're called work camps or like workshops, you know, conferences basically all over Europe, and I would just do presentations and all that kind of stuff and just, you know, interact with the community. And the project that I was working on at the time, W3 Total Cash, it's one of the hardest problems to solve, right? It's caching. Right? So if you get any kind of engineering degree, specifically computer science, like there's two hard things, right? What to call things, which is hard even outside of computer science, right? And then thing two is what to cache, because caching means that, you know, you are not starting from scratch, like figuring out what the answer to a question is, you're holding on to that answer to the question, that's caching, right? So like in your, like when you draft an email and you send it, that's like a cache, or save it, that's like a cache, right? Just hold it on to that thing so you can do something with it in the future. So anyway, the plugin does that and it scales WordPress sites which don't scale by themselves. And so what I did with that particular project is right from the beginning, I started doing something that I didn't realize other people weren't doing, which was, you know, ultimately became an unfair advantage. So thing one is I started selling stuff. So I sold in two ways. Way one is you can pay me to like respond to you, which is a novel thing. It's called support. Do you know what I mean? But like in open source, there's no such thing in the sense that there's way too many users compared to developers. And there's no real sustainable business model in open source. All the real sustainable business models are you test something in open source communities, like try to create some value, you learn something from it, and then you make a commercial version. That's normally how it works, right? This probably sounds familiar to a lot of you. And so I just did both at once. Started with support, then added services on top, and then added software subscriptions on top of that. And so the interesting thing about WordPress, the unfair advantage of making that business model is if you build something that solves a problem and creates enough value, then people will talk about it, they'll share it, they'll use it, they'll, like, unfortunately, they'll either be very angry or very happy, there's not really anything in between. Like, oh, this changed my life, oh, you know, I hate you. But I'd be at conferences and things like that, and, you know, there would be young upstarts trying to do something in WordPress and be like, oh yeah, you actually changed my life, I learned a lot from this. So like, that's a rewarding thing. But the most probably important thing that I learned is like, things aren't really what they seem, right? So just in the same way that you can create an unfair advantage, you can just change the way things work. You just have to commit, right? So like, I've spent 2.5 years working on a project, which nobody really wanted to undertake. Right, they're like, that's too expensive, that's ambitious, that's too hard, and then just don't stop. Right, so be committed. So whatever it is you want to do, I mean, you know, Oculus is crushing it. Like, I don't know what you're doing, you can tell me after this. But
it's like, compatible with Oculus, so we're not competing.
Okay, good answer. But like, I promise you that if you start doing really well, like, you're going to compete, because that's just the nature of things, right? So like, eventually you're going to change it up, you're going to switch it up. Got to be committed, got to keep going. There's nothing wrong with solving a hard problem. There's only something out. It's the same thing as stopping. So if you haven't learned that lesson, you're welcome. Okay? It doesn't mean like slowing down is necessarily like unacceptable, right? Sometimes you just can't like do it. But like slow down intentionally. Does that make sense? You know, make it deliberate, have a strategy, is all I'm saying. But anyway, after working on W3 Total Cash, you know, I really spent a lot of time at that point working with a young man that I met while I was still in Boston who was working on a different venture at the time, something different than what Placester became. And so when I first met him, I was like still doing stuff for my own agency. You know, I was, you know, spending only a little time at Mashable, ultimately moving into an advisory role. And then, you know, the open source project was just something that I did for fun because the first year that we were in Italy, I didn't really have a specific place that we stayed in. We moved around every quarter because, you know, do you know what Italy's like? Right? So you move around and figure it out. But ultimately, ended up in the city, but the key there is made a good friend, and like what you guys need to do and ladies need to do, I think, is whether that person is up here, like across the table from you as a partner, you need someone that, you need a number two, right? You need probably a number three. And one of the things that I usually see go wrong is folks can't find a great partner, someone independent. Because like, there's things in life, and I think we've all realized this before, you can obviously cover an awful lot of ground if you just go, like, instead of trying to explain it to people and wait for people to come through and like, you know, all those things in life, you just go try to do it. But there's a big, big difference when you have like 45, 8,000, and pick a number, more than one, people doing it with you, right? And so that's a completely different skill, a completely different muscle. And like you probably know, like Jeff Bezos, Steve Jobs, all those guys, difficult to work with, but they change stuff. So I don't really know what it's like to work with them. Obviously, I don't, not a lot of people do, but those people don't stop. They create unfair advantages. They focus, and you know, I think probably one of the biggest things is, you know, they just change the way things work, right? And like some of that, like if you're the leader on the team in which you're working, you need to be that rock, that person that everybody looks at as, you know, the leader. And if you're not that person, that's okay, right? But you need to find that person because they need to be in your organization, you know. And then you need to work on making sure that you're influential, right? If you actually want to be there. Because I would imagine if you're entrepreneurial, that's like you want to change stuff, right? Like raise your hand if that's not true. Trick to you. And so anyway, hopefully that stuff makes sense, right? So now at Placester, what we do is we make a digital marketing platform for real estate. The reason why that's really hard is there's like a 15-year-old data problem. So like everybody knows how the internet works. People write articles, Google sends traffic to them, people like share it on social, or they make vines, or they do whatever they do, and then everybody goes and looks at it and like laughs, or like says, "Oh, about the cat," or whatever it is, and they enjoy it. In real estate, the content is articles, in some cases, writing about neighborhoods, you know, housing porn, they call it, like, look at Kobe Bryant's house, right? That's what they call housing porn. And then they have property listings, because, like, all you care about is the home. Do you know what I mean? You don't want to, like, read about the home. You want to look at the home and then read about it more, right, if it's interesting. So anyway, they put, real estate professionals put their listings in the wrong databases by that 906 different databases. So we had to spend 2.5 years getting the data out to be able to give each agent their own website. Because if you don't do that, the individual agents can't market themselves. And they have to market themselves. Like who's bought or sold a home or rented an apartment? Everybody, right? Who didn't use an agent? That's what I thought. All right, you guys are special. So 3 people out of everybody. So like the point is, those real estate professionals, they build our communities. They have the networks of professionals that like make things happen. They're enablers, right? They're hubs, if you will. So anyway, they are independent. Their broker doesn't, you know, say to them like, "Hey John, how was your weekend? You know, here's 15 leads, go be rich," right? Like if that was how real estate worked, we would not be in this room. We would all be real estate agents, right? So some dude's just like, "Money," but it doesn't work. So anyway, they gotta do it themselves. So we build a platform that helps them do that, right, using the web. Solving this problem that's 15 years old. Easiest way to think about it is like, you know, healthcare, right? You see sometimes some hospitals, like, you know, nurses and doctors walking around with iPads, right? If you ask them like, "Hey, can you pull my medical history from when I was 7? They'd be like, "Hang on," because they gotta go look at another computer. It's not an iPad, right? Data problem, it's broken. Same thing in real estate. Does that make sense? What else you wanna talk about?
Well, I have a few questions, but I think you covered a lot, so I mean, I want to open it up to you guys first. Anybody have any questions that you guys want to ask? I think there's a lot there that, you
know. How many people are at Placester?
80.
80?
So you touched on a couple of interesting points, but just case in point, I'm in financial services, and I'm looking to transition career-wise into the tech sector, so I'm working trying to figure out what niche, what role I can play. Any advice for someone trying to transition into the technology world?
Yeah, I mean, I would go back to a point I made earlier. Do you have someone you can look at that says, this guy has or lady has what I want? I would identify that person first, because one of the best things is, I mean, so many things in life work like this. There's usually some kind of playbook. There's some kind of pattern. What you don't want to do, right, pausing for effect, what you don't want to do is figure it out from scratch. Everybody knows the expression, reinvent the wheel. Don't do it. If you want to be original, like, do that when you're old. Don't try to be original in the sense that, like, I'm going to carve this out, I'm going to make some new title, I'm not making fun of you, I'm just like being ridiculous. I'm going to make a new title, I'm going to change the game. No. It's like all the greatest football coaches, sorry for a sports analogy, right? All the best football coaches will be like, you could have a championship Super Bowl winning team, okay, first day of practice with all these athletes that make too many millions of dollars is, gentlemen, this is a football, right? It's not like, oh, you guys are perfect, let's talk about something that has nothing to do, no, it's fundamentals. So the fundamental thing for you trying to make a move is, who do I copy? When you get that down, like, what's that playbook, interview that person, buy them dinner, you know, babysit their kids, like, whatever it is to get them to spend time with you, so you don't have to figure out what they did. Right? If they don't have, if you like spend time with them, it turns out they don't have the quality, like the juice wasn't worth the squeeze, it doesn't look like they can help you. They got a free meal, you made a friend, you know, but identify that person so you can like not figure out from scratch, oh, I have three degrees now and I still don't have the thing I want. Like, I'm sure we know friends like that like just won't leave school, they just keep going. And right, everybody's laughing, like, no, I know that dude. So that would be my best advice to you. You really want to know exactly what it is in detail that it looks like. So you're going to define success. It can be, you know, two houses. I'm just saying monetary things. Right? It could be two houses. It could be, you know, family, 18 kids. It could be whatever. Like, define it. Identify that person that's done it. Spend time with them. And then dig in. Figure out what your roadmap looks like. And back into it. Right? And then sprint. Then like do what you can to be original and how fast you get it done. That is, I don't know, I'm not aware of any better life advice. Right? My pleasure. Anybody else?
Yeah, thank you for the sharing your stories. So it looks like that there are so many opportunities and possibilities if you're looking from a technical background, for example, you mentioned. There are so many areas you can explore, but how do you find which one is the one you'll have an advantage in looking better than others?
Well, you're gonna have to do some experimentation, so it goes back to this question as well. So I'll explain the answer from a completely different point of view. You're going to have to, for example, Treehouse didn't exist when I was coming up, right? By coming up, I mean like 15 years ago. So what can you do then? Well, if it's the web, and there are other, like, you know, platforms for different types of skill building, right? This is a platform for skill building, General Assembly, right? Use these platforms to get a little taste of what these things are. Similarly, maybe it's not a professional thing you want to do, maybe it's just like my personal satisfaction, my like intellectual stimulation. I want to find someone that's excellent at a thing. Well, you can Google all those people. They don't always write you back, but generally speaking, if you write them on Twitter, most people hit you back, and you can start making relationships, right? Like, you're already doing a lot of the healthy behaviors right now. You're around other people that are trying to solve the same problem, talk to them, right? So that's a good move. But I would find a platform that makes it low risk to try a number of different things, and then I would render that against or marry that with like identifying a role model, a mentor, someone who's got something that you're interested in, and then trying to interview them and figure out how they did it. And most people, when you ask them questions, deja vu, they're gonna be like, don't do any of these things. Like, these are bad things. And then there's your shortcut, right? And the only problem you'll have is like, you know, back then, like they didn't have cars or something stupid. Like, there'll be some little nuanced thing that like isn't true anymore, but it won't matter because they would have told you something that it took them 20 years to figure out. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
What's the biggest lesson you learned in building Mashable?
Wow. That is tricky. How about top two things? Top two things are, you never know what's going to happen. Right? So Mashable was a self-funded thing, and you know, there's a lot of other people that did quite a bit of work to contribute to what it became. Okay? So it's not like, you know, Pete was one of them. Like, he was by himself, like, you know, in Scotland, which, you know, in movies looks great, but in winter sounds awful, right? So, you know, that's why he's the founder. But it was the value of a team and not giving up, because you don't know what's going to happen. Right? You can, generally speaking, get great feedback that you're creating value and that people like what you're doing. In other words, you know, that things are working. we don't really know. There have been media companies since the beginning of time, right? And then all the other things I said before would follow in terms of lessons learned, like create an unfair advantage, you know, all that stuff. Make sense?
That first sales guy who you said you built up to 60,000, what was like the initial agreement with him? Like, did you make him sign something?
Nope.
No?
I just said you want a job. And I guess that's a lesson too. It's like, this is the thing that is still a little surprising today. I'm gonna say it in a messed up way. And I want you guys to like try to appreciate this point. Society literally makes employees for you. Right. When you're an entrepreneur, okay, you're literally going through the exact same conditioning as the rest of society, and for some reason, there's something that's making you be like, you know what, I'm not doing it. I'm doing something different, and you're gonna help me do it. And people are like, and the reason why they do that is because society makes employees for you. What does that really mean? It means don't be surprised that people will want to join your team and contribute to the thing that you're doing, right? Because everybody wants to follow a great leader, even when they can't be close to them. You know, like Dre released, you know, on Beats One, his album pre-order. I was like, boop, got it. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know Dre. He had a profound impact on my life. He just got, I didn't even look at the price. I was like, I'll have that, right? Can't get anywhere else? Yep, give it to me. Like, just like put it in my account. And the reason why I'm saying that is because you'll meet a whole bunch of people. You're gonna have to craft your story. It's gonna have to make sense. You're gonna have to prove things out. You're gonna have to create value. Like, it's gotta be real. You can't like be a snake oil salesman or saleswoman, okay? But, you know, there are a whole bunch of people running around that want jobs. And their perfect job is usually like following a great leader, right? So a company with a great mission and all this stuff that actually creates real value so that they can be passionate about it. Why? Because they don't want to be entrepreneurs. You guys take risks. Society doesn't make risk takers. So why did that guy want a job? Because everybody wants a job. What did I say to that guy? Do you want a job? And he's like, you know, the only contract I had with him was that I would help him make money. And then I did. And he was happy.
So you didn't give him like a base salary, you just said strictly commission?
Yep. Okay. It's like, what do you offer? No base. Got it. What are you going to do? I'm going to help you make money. He's like, I'll try. And if he didn't, then I would keep going. Hey, bro, no base. Got it. Here's one. Get another one. Right? I mean, it's like that. It's like, what, P. Diddy, or what's his name now, right? He's like, bad boy, right? Till like his throat rotted. Don't stop, right? You just keep seeing it time and again. It's just like, don't forget, don't stop. That's it. Go back to the beginning. Don't stop, I'm tired, don't stop, I'm tired, don't, right? How many people remember staying up all night studying for exams? Do you remember like what it feels like though? Do you remember the pain? Right? Do you remember walking around like a zombie that next day? Like, no, not really. No, not really. Like, who remembers like a long workout, going for a long run, being sore? Like, you can understand the concept of being sore, right? Like, you know, I'm uncomfortable all day. Like, I don't like my body. Give me another one. And then after that, it wears off. And for some reason, you go do it again. So what is the point? The point is, pain is temporary. Run towards it, right? Said the fat guy, like, I'm overweight now. But like, you know, just run towards the pain. Why? Because nobody else is gonna do it. They're like, I'm not an entrepreneur. Oh, you're gonna take a risk? Yeah, I'll follow you. We just talked about it. It's all the same.
What do you think makes a leader?
There are so many types. Single parent families, phenomenal leadership. You know, there's people that are like behind the scenes, right? That are not the figurehead of an organization or a team or the cool kid, but they are the enablers. They make people happy. that's terrific leadership. Like that, those two cases are examples of like phenomenal leadership that is like unparalleled. And then there's like conspicuous leadership, you know, people that are motivational, that are captivating, have like that distortion field, like they do Jedi mind tricks on people. You know, like it depends on the problem that you're solving. Because, you know, I mean, we'd have to dig into an example. Say, hey, I want to be a great CEO. What does that look like? Well, you have to be a servant leader. That'd be the number one thing that I would suggest. It's like, I'll do one-on-ones. Like, does everybody know all the corporate speak and stuff, right? It's like, you know, there's like cross-functional meetings, one-on-one meetings. It's like me and you, cross-functional. It's like you, your team. And like, we're going to talk about some initiatives, some projects we have to create value in the business, right? And then a one-on-one, I'll be like, first thing I'll say is, how are we doing? Right? So I'm asking them, like, how's the company treating you? Second question, do you need anything? Right? And then, and like, those are the easy ones. The hard one is, like, last night, for example, we had to expand into the suite above. These guys were running the networking and stuff. They come in at, like, 9, they're working all night. It's, like, 5 in the morning. The internet breaks. No, 3 in the morning, excuse me. The internet breaks. So think about this. 80 times $8 burned if the internet doesn't work, right? I mean, it's like, whoops. Like, how do you explain that, you know, to anybody? Imagine, you know, you just told your mom, sorry, mom, I spent, you know, 80 times, you know, some hourly rate times $8 today. I mean, that'd be the end. You're no longer in that family. You're outside of the house watching them eat. You know what I mean? Like, it's over, right? And so the internet broke, so I had to wake somebody out of bed that did something that caused the problem, and I'd be nice to them. Okay, I'll just be honest, that's not in my DNA. I did not want to be pleasant at 3 in the morning dealing with a situation that I had systematically tried to avoid. You know what I mean? It's not like a car accident. It's like, whoops, you know, like, that's what accident means. Like, sorry, accident, right? It was like, did you do your job? Oh, you didn't. Right, and I'm up at 3 in the morning and I'm not supposed to be. Great, I'm gonna call you and you're gonna come here and you're gonna fix this, right? And then after that, it's like 5 in the morning, work's still not done, you know, but all I can think about is if everyone else can't do their work, it's not okay. Right, servant leadership. And there's bazillions of examples. It's like, it's not just like, oh, I'm gonna get munchkins for the team on Mondays, but you can do that too. You know, there's a whole bunch of things. You can Google that, you can read about it, you can make it your own. It depends on what problem you're solving, what kind of organization you want to have, what role you're playing. But you don't have to be the CEO to be a servant leader. You know, just about every great parent I've ever seen is a servant leader. Like a little kid's telling you no, like it's this big. You're like, no, it's like, really? You know, so like if you're gonna be, show that understanding, that care, facilitate, empower, enable, all those things, servant leadership.
So I want to get to the thing before the colon, the title of Black Excellence. And in a time when we hear about the diversity in tech, and you hear about a lot of efforts to allow women to gain a better foothold in tech entrepreneurship, I want to get your perspective on not the how to, but the hot spots of who is looking for a diverse tech in the country, both from a development side and the funding side. And then we know about NUMMI and Platform and Digital Undivided and Power Moves and all these places where they're crucibles and incubators and accelerators. But you said that from your vantage point looking in, what do you think are the best hot heat sources for both mentorship and resources for this?
It's really challenging to name a few things. Like, so, you know, there's a reason why like minority is a word, right? It's like you're outnumbered. Right? Similarly in the organizations, the organizations are outnumbered, right? So I tend not to think about things in that way exactly. What I tend to find is that although communities and organizations are phenomenal and they're empowering and they're like, you know, they enable all that great stuff, in my personal experience, I haven't found that I would move from A to B as fast as if I would just figure out the thing that I wanted and go get into it. Now, it doesn't mean that I don't need help like everybody else needs help. And that's what communities are great for. But if you're specifically talking about you know, which community has the leaders that are is most likely to have the leaders or the mentors that are going to help you, like, you know, save time and, like, be your unfair advantage from a time perspective. I don't have a short list of those things. You know, a lot of my earliest mentors were, I would have never imagined, ever. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's, there was no, like, so Techstars is an accelerator, right? They don't care who joins. Harder to get into than Harvard, you just have to be good at creating value because that's what businesses do, right? So you get in there, and then they show, you can go look at their website right now. They got a roster of all these mentors. So they're a mentorship-driven organization. So folks from all walks of life, across all industries that have done all types of businesses and, you know, different things. Some of them haven't even been, you know, on the leadership or management teams. They're just excellent at their craft, whatever that thing is, right? So they can help you with your mobile app kind of thing, okay? I tend to just look at, like, as I suggested, I tend to look at folks who have accomplished the thing that I want, which means I've got to make up my mind, right? And just a quick aside, okay, you have to make up your mind in order to change it. I don't know if you think about it that way, but if you do, you go faster. It's like, I don't know what I'm going to do today. Just pick something. Then change your mind. That is way faster than being like, oh. And then time passes. Right? But anyway, I would just look at those people that were doing things and be like, oh man, Neil Patel, this guy's got a phenomenal organization. Like, how is he selling? Like, how does he go to market? What is he offering? What does he charge? Right? Who are his friends? Who's in his community? And it has nothing to do with, you know, a minority organization. It has everything to do with how does that world work? How do I get into it? How to create value in there? Right? That's all I really think about. So that's not to say that, like, there's anything wrong with the question. But what you're gonna find is, like, the world automatically has diversity in it. And, like, usually the smaller the community, the less diversity there is. And so in terms of, like, you know, females in tech, for example, okay, hardest thing ever. And I say that because I'm delighted when I see, you know, I get a CV and someone and a female has experience and everything else, because what I, like, this is what I think, and I probably shouldn't, you know, probably shouldn't say it, but, like, it's just going to make everybody act better when it's not all dudes running around. When there's ladies running around, you got to be gentlemen. That's better for the business, right? It makes perfect sense. Everything's in balance. Same thing with seniority. You need senior people and you need junior people, because people need to, like, promotions come from growing the team. Not everybody can be senior. Some people need to, like, you know, like, break their teeth on learning some things, and they shouldn't break their teeth, like, learning the core thing the business does. That's like a recipe for disaster. It's like, you got an 8-year-old kid, and you're like, hey, you know, build this app for me. You know, it's like, no, that doesn't make any sense, right? So anyway, I'm always excited when you happen to find one, but I think the problem's in the supply, not in the demand. That makes sense. So I didn't mean to give you a non-answer, but it's, like, it's obviously complicated.
How do you think about the scaling of your businesses? You guys are growing really fast, getting funding, etc. How do you go from, you know, you and your co-founder to where you are now, 80 people? What are the challenges you kind of face, and how do you overcome that? Large question.
Yeah, some of the larger challenges. I think some of the reason why I asked about early stage early at the beginning is because one of the biggest things is, you know, what does value look like for your customer? So once you figure out your market, you figure out, like, you know, the opportunity size looks like, figure out, like, what the needs are, right, what your customer is looking for. And then you start to figure out how to develop those customers and what you need to offer them, like what the product is, the thing that you trade for their dollars, right? That product market fit thing, after you do all the formality to kind of distill down into what that is, that's a challenging thing because you don't ever finish that activity. You just get better at it, right? So you make your first app, you know, you've got your marketplace up and everything else, and the first thing you find out is you're not done. Right, so you're really proud, you learned a lot, you shipped the thing, you know, people are like, oh, that's hot, you know, yeah, I'll have that, here's my money, or whatever, you do your business development, you get folks in your marketplace, dollars are flowing through it, and you've got to keep iterating, And what you'll find is if you go too slow, like, you lose your relevance, right? When we think about the entertainment industry, like, that's what we think about. Like, to be Dr. Dre and, like, be nascent or silent for a decade and a half and be like, oh, I'm dropping an album and everybody's like, double click on that, do you know what I mean, isn't normal. Like, most people can't, like, that's like lottery winning level of, you know, echelon of authority or value. So, like, product market fit and iterating on that to maintain your relevance, I think, is one of the hardest things. You have to, like, build that muscle and keep doing it. And the next thing you need to do is you need to just figure out how to organize a team. Right? So once you have your mission and your values and your positioning and your, you know, I already say vision, and you get everybody aligned around that, you've got to get folks with, preferably with some experience, you know, doing some of the core capabilities like in a software as a service company or most businesses. To get those functions set up with people that have some idea of how to do them already. And then the best thing, you know, perfect role, and this is really challenging, but like mentors are great for this. You can figure out how to do each one of those functions yourself because you did them first. So I'll say it differently. Every great organization starts with, you know, people, the leadership, replacing themselves. I used to do sales, and I got a sales guy. Right? I used to do engineering, and I got some engineers. Right? You go around, build the functions of the business. The weakest leaders that I've ever seen don't actually understand how those businesses function. Doesn't mean you have to be the best at it, you have to understand it, right? Like, we can all drive, right? Do you guys consider yourselves to be the best drivers? You don't have to be. I think you're licensed, right? That's all that I'm saying. So you have to be able to, like, do that. Are you laughing because, like, she's not that good? I'm just teasing. So anyway, that's one of the key things. You build out those functions, and then you have to start to figure out what contribution to the goals of the business is that function making? Mm-hmm. And then you start to drill into, okay, if we do this, we're gonna create this value, and that's gonna contribute to, you know, whatever else. And then who's supporting that? Like, who on other teams is contributing to that? So an easy example is in a software company. I have 50 customers demanding X feature, and I know that they'll pay $15 each, or let's pick a bigger number so it sounds more interesting. $1,500 each if we have this feature. Spoke to engineering. Engineering is going to, like, build this thing in 3 weeks. That means we're going to get all that business value, right? Everybody's aligned. They're like, okay, if the market has just told us exactly what to make, it's like, welcome to McDonald's. Like, what would you like, right? I would like a cheeseburger. It's like, great. And then they go in the back and they're like, we got a customer that wants a cheeseburger. And he's in, right? It's not complicated, right? You know this already. Right? And then the engineer, so the chef in this case, is like, oh shit, well, here we go. And you, like, put it on a tray. And that's a business where there's not even, like, you know, the guy with the, you know, the waiter guy, like, serving you. And they still crush it. So you just figure out how to get your organization, your teams, to make that burger. Right? You just don't stop. You know, you make a better burger, right? You know, depending on your business, you might make a McDonald's, and then you make a, you know, a number nine, or, you know, pick your favorite posh restaurant. Like, you just, you know, serve different types of customers. And in each business, you still use the same process. So the biggest thing has been figuring out how to do those things efficiently, and then how to help people know when they're doing well, so they can be accountable. Because, like, one of the things great people want is they want autonomy. They don't want to be micromanaged. Right, so the analogy I use is, like, you know, someone holding your hand as you're typing on the computer. That's how I think about micromanagement. And, like, I don't know if any of you have been micromanaged, but, like, it's not fun. So if you want to create an organization where that doesn't have to happen, you've got to create alignment, because really what you want is you want to be able to agree philosophically and tactically, and then be able to have a discussion that says, hey man, or, like, the analogy I had earlier is, like, hey, we gotta make, you know, 4,000 burgers on this grill, like, how do you wanna do it? Then have a game plan, and then be able to replace yourself, walk away from that. And you will come back, and there'll be all those burgers, and you will have to ask, how did you do it? And they'll be like, well, we talked about it, we said we were gonna do this, but then what we learned was, if we did it like this other way, it would be better. And you're like, oh, word, that's great, here's some more money, keep going. And then they get a promotion, right? That's that. And then figuring out how to, like, make everybody believe that. Because most people come in jaded with a job. The way that I explain it is, even if they never had a job before, employees always carry two bags to work. Bag one is their personal issues. Let's just put it like that. And then bag two is their professional issues. So even if you haven't had a job before, you're projecting into your new opportunity like how that business needs to work. Right? Does that make sense? And if you've had a job before, you're like, probably left because for not a good reason, because if everything was great, you'd still be over there, right? I mean, the logic is pretty simple. And then on the personal side, I mean, everybody's just got stuff. I mean, raise your hand if you're perfect, right? And so those people, every single person, because they carry those two bags, you as their leader, right, their manager, whatever you want to call it, you have to figure out how to help them with those things. And some of them you can't help with because they're personal. So you're like, hey, where do you want to go in your life? Great, do you have a mentor? Someone who's not me, who's going to spend time with you to help you with whatever you need to help with. So a lot of those kinds of activities and then just iterate. Hey, we think this is how we're going to grow the business and then we find some new customer market. What kind of partners you use changes. And you need to just be agile in dealing with those kinds of changes.
What metrics do you use to determine short-term progress and success?
That's a hard question. It depends on what you want. So I'll say this, because this is the warning. Whatever you measure is what you get, which is a trick. So I'll give you an example of doing it wrong. Let's say, what is it that you're working on?
So a couple of projects, but one being a business accelerator.
Okay. Well, one that you definitely want to get right is involves the definition of your metrics, right? So by that I mean, you can very easily say, hey, I care about business value. I want to identify opportunities, I want to attribute some dollar value to them, and then I want to do some activities that allow me to recognize that, that business value, right? Like I was talking about before with the burger, okay? And so, that one's pretty straightforward, but you can very easily get into ones that are weird. So let's this is one I think is accessible to everybody. So for example, let's say you need to sell stuff over the phone to you. Okay? So what do? You start getting people that know how to sell over the phone. That's actually different than people that sell in the field. Right? So that's why I'm saying I don't mean to sound stupid. And so the point is they're sitting at their desks dialing for dollars, as they say, okay, and say you want to track their performance to figure out if they're gonna add the revenue that you expect them to add by dials. Like how many people do they call? And by how much time they spend on the phone, right? And by the estimated size of the opportunity of the person that they spoke to. Okay? Those would all sound really straightforward, logical things to measure, right? So you could look at week over week and be like, yeah, we called 3,700 people. We spent 1,700 hours on the phone. I'm picking numbers, right? It probably doesn't make sense. And so on, okay? And so what would you find? You would find that has nothing to do with whether or not people were good on the phone, called the right people, like so qualified lead, okay? Like as opposed to like, they all called their moms and their cousins. You know what I mean? It's like, but that would look like dials. You'd be like, yes, more dials. Yes, give me more dials. This is gonna be good. It's like, no. Are they qualified? Right? And so what does qualified mean? And that's why I said definitions earlier. You're like, okay guys, qualified means they're not your parents. And you break it down, right? I'm not trying to be silly, like you will have this. That's why I said the first thing, like, you'll get what you measure. Not that people try to take advantage of you, but like, if you're leading them, you have to be like, this is what success looks like. Here's a, jigsaw is like a database of all these executives. If you're selling like enterprise software, be like, call all these people. Here's what you say. Here's how you handle objections, right? And then you say, for however many calls they make, it's like, what is your process? How are you moving it through the funnel of an opportunity to revenue? And then what I would recommend is measuring people moving through that funnel, through those milestones from, I don't know this person to, this person is a customer, as opposed to the activity metrics. Yeah, we called a lot of people. I don't know why this isn't working. A lot of people answered, and I spoke for a long time with them, right? Those metrics don't tell you if you're gonna get paid. Is that helpful?
It is. Thanks.
Okay. Anybody else?
Is there like like one or two books that you find that you recommend to people all the time?
Art of War is good. How to Win Friends and Influence People is good. I like to read a lot of the biographies of people. The Steve Jobs one wasn't bad. I don't know. There's a lot of them out there. Those are the only ones that are top of mind. So.
Transferable skills. Talk about one of the things that I've been dealing with is I'm coming out of nonprofits, organizational development, and getting into tech. And I seem to get around a lot of individuals, and all of the things that I know kind of threaten others. And I like to like bring value. Mm-hmm. I don't like to threaten. So it's like when you're dealing with like transferable skills, there's things that you don't talk about that might bring some sort of, you know, threat to the individual, or other things that you do talk about to build value to that individual. That's something I've been dealing with. It's like coming out of nonprofit management, going into tech, and it kind of distances me sometimes, depending on who I'm talking to.
Can you give me a for instance? Because like the way you put it just makes me want to be like, yes.
Well, for instance, like management and like event planning. I've done fundraisers, but I've also like micromanaged every part of the fundraiser and every team member involved in executing the fundraiser. So what's happened a lot of times when you get around people, I get down to the minutia and technical side of things, and they're like, whoa, like I didn't think of all those things. Mm. Like maybe you might be a little too much for us because of the way you think.
Yes. So, man, I'm so glad you asked that. So this is very difficult, okay? So it's like, bad analogy, it's like dating. You're sitting there with someone, doesn't matter like which gender you are, they're coming on too strong. It's like, whoa, 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 right? I just learned your name, chill out, right, kind of thing. And, you know, I know it's not exactly like that, but like, that's what the other person is feeling. They're like, we just went to a place, I'm not ready for that place. They're like, stop. So what do you do about that? Well, one of the things that I do is I ask questions. Because like what I find is, because earlier I was encouraging folks to be technical. Well, what does that mean? It means part of the other thing I said is you have to be cross-functional. So you're talking to non-technical people. Or forget technical versus not. You're talking to people that don't have your unfair advantage. Right? They're looking to you for leadership. They're like, oh, word, yes, you can do this, wonderful, like, do it. Like, for most people, that is it. That is all they've thought, right, when they're working with you. They're like, great, we agree, you're gonna do this thing, awesome. And then that's it, checked out. So then when you start drilling in, they're like, where are we drilling? What is happening right now? That's what's happening, right? And they're like, whoa, right, you can't fix that. So all you can do is figure out like what their comfort level is with things. You can work on messaging to them like what value is and like how what your process is, so they can at least follow along with your playbook, right? And then, you know, if people aren't, for example, if you're selling this stuff, people aren't like appreciating your value, right? You need to just find better customers, right? Because like another thing that you will find is like, the more sophisticated your customer, generally speaking, the more successful they are, usually the more money they have to spend on your stuff, and like the easier it is to like, you know, like demonstrate your value by like drilling in. Right? It's not like, when you think about it like that, it's like, oh, it makes sense. I'm talking to someone that's like not very initiated, so I shouldn't dig very deeply. Maybe this person is like new at this thing, they don't have my experience, so what am I gonna do? Well, I'm just gonna be like, look, here's my plan. This is gonna happen, and this is gonna happen, and this is gonna happen, and right? And you break it down. And then what do you do after that? You're like, remember we agreed, this was gonna happen, and then this was gonna, and then you say like, okay, that happened. Did you, okay, yeah, this one happened, did you suck, okay. And you just show them that you did those things, and that there are things that they can recognize and identify, you're good. And then on your own, just get better at your craft. The technical stuff, the soft skills, the messaging, the selling. Right?
But how does that deal with the stigma of being authoritative? I mean, that's still
there.
Because
the value is in demonstrating. for when people don't understand, they need to be shown. So leadership is like, watch me. I'm gonna model the behavior. Like dad is like walking like this. Mm-hmm. And next thing you know, youngster is walking like this, right? So that's why. Everything, like, what people don't understand, you usually have to model the behavior. So when you present the plan and you make sure it's understood, which sometimes might require you to drill down, so I realize, like, I'm, like, contradicting myself to use your judgment, okay? But when you present the plan and then you demonstrate, like, they sign off on it, like, yes, I have seen that you have achieved this, thank you very much, right? And you keep going. Then it's like, okay, for this engagement, we agreed I was going to do these six things. At every single milestone you saw that I did, give me all of your money. Or whatever, right? Give me, like, the next opportunity. Whatever it is you agreed that you were going to get. So I don't think that necessarily takes anything away from him. And then in a perfect world, you know, because it can go too far the other way, too. It's a pendulum, right? It swings too far the other way. Your customer's too technical. They're like, oh, you're not using the words that I expected. I'm very technical in this area. And they're just like, and he's like, oh, snap. You know, I was like, normally I'm like really good. This person has a strong point of view. And like, they're not even meeting me halfway to figure out how I think versus how they think. And maybe there's something, you know, good in the middle. Right? So, you know, you got to feel it out. But like, usually the best thing to do is just like to show and prove. Does that make sense?
Good enough.
Okay.
All right, so guys, we'll make this the last one. I know we had from 7 days, so I want to give Frederick back tonight. But
so in the startup space that I'm familiar with, venture funding is almost like a given that the company will go seek venture funding. Can you talk about your opinion on whether the like undertaking that is worth it, or is like really anything? Huh?
What is worth it mean?
That there are companies that have become successful without it, mm-hmm. but there are also companies that have become successful with it. If you're gonna go seek venture funding, it's almost like a full-time job. How would that decision-making process, like, what advice would you have about that decision-making process?
I tend to go back to the fundamental. So I would talk to someone who's done it. Pick someone who's done something very, very similar, so at least the same industry, ask them about their journey, especially if they weren't successful. And like, as long as they're not jaded, right? Because like, most businesses fail, right? Why? Because most businesses they're small, right? And like, small businesses run every economy, and not every business can be relevant for a long period of time, right? In other words, like, there's a reason why there's a Fortune, you know, 100 and 1,000 and so on. It's because like, they are the lottery winners, basically, okay? So I would try to learn as much as you can about the process, like how it works. Like, what are financial partners looking for? Oh, well, they're looking for 30% of your business because they expect that it's going to become more valuable, right? So what do you do to affect them? Maybe you only sell them 20%, right? All of them, like, how do you negotiate the deal? Like, you know, maybe you don't actually do, you know, priced rounds. Maybe you do convertible notes, or you do safe rounds. You can do all these different, there's all these different vehicles to capitalize your business, right? So you drill into those, try to understand them. You don't need an MBA to do it, you just need to like think about it, right? And then you talk to the financial partners that do those types of deals, and you make sure that you've got a business that's gonna actually make money, right? Like, not in a like, I'm supremely confident that this is like $800 trillion business, you know, like nobody knows, but like, I've sat down with VCs in there and I was like, I don't know exactly how much, like, I don't know what this market size is. I think it's like $2 billion. They're like, just make it up. Right? So I say that to you not because they're all like that. I say that to you because they're just people and they're trying to make a calculated bet on someone who wants to take a risk for them, basically. Like, you know, some people say, for better or for worse, that entrepreneurs are the product of VC firms, right? Like, you're the people that create the value. Right? That's the trade. And so you need to figure out how that process works, if you were to do it, what makes sense for you, and then how that fits into your strategy so that, you know, when you pick a partner, they're usually gonna, like, depending on how you finance the business, they're usually gonna follow on for subsequent rounds, which basically means, like, let's say they put in $3 million, then they expect you to create more value in the business, like the business is worth more money, and then they want to put in more money into the business, either to scale it or grow it, or to defend their ownership as other investors come in, right? You know this kind of stuff, okay? So investors don't usually, like, outside of angels, who obviously don't just have as much money, literally, like, they don't, but that's okay. But outside of them, all your institutional investors are going to want to continue to, like, put money into your business because they're trying to get an exit out the other side. 8-year fund, 10-year fund, they want to give all their liability, you know, their, all their partners that put the money in there, they want to give them a return. And so they just want you to be successful. So if you want to have a big business and you want to have it in an unreasonable amount of time, you're usually going to want help in the form of outside capital, right? So it all goes back to what is success for you. You know, you want to make $3 or $4 million and have, you know, a year and have 5 employees because, okay, then that's what it is. Okay, so what business gives you that? What model makes that happen? You want to have just a huge, huge business? Well, you can either take a very, 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 very long time, right? Because you're literally buying time. They're like, here's a whole bunch of time, right? And you get a whole bunch of people that put 8 hours a day into whatever you're doing, and you're buying time. So you got to think about if, like, how big you want it to be, because otherwise it's going to take you, relatively speaking, a long time to get a whole bunch of people for you to afford a whole bunch of other people's time. It boils down to that. And if that makes sense, then how you want to grow your business, how big you want it to be, you know, all those things come into view. And then at the end of the day, venture capitalists are just humans. So you're going to go sit with them. Yeah, it takes a lot of time, but you're going to hang out with them and they're going to be like, oh, you need to know how to do this thing? Here's 4 companies that do this exact thing. Go talk to their leadership. And you know what I mean? And like, but otherwise, you cannot talk to them. Right? Because those other people who are building a big business, they only talk to the other people. That's like a community, right? They only talk to the other people that are doing that thing. Because otherwise they're wasting their time. They're like adding risk to like whether or not they're going to be able to continue. So I would think about some of those things. Like it's the community. It's like how big do you want your business to be? How fast do you want to do it? What is success for you? All those kinds of things. Because neither one is bad. There's just life. It's trade-offs. Is that helpful?
Awesome. Thanks.
My pleasure.
Appreciate you taking the time.